The thing she would save from her burning house, there's two items. One is a diary, which makes sense. And the second thing is a teddy bear, which she already pulled out of a burning house once before. Her childhood teddy bear. Very, very cool. Ninjas versus pirates, without hesitation. She said ninjas, because that's the right answer. And cake versus pie, without hesitation, cake. Her talk is called The Fiction of Memory. Please welcome Elizabeth Loftus.
Thanks for that introduction. It's a pleasure to be here with you and talk to you about the work that I've been doing for the last four decades in the area of human memory. So human memory, it's a pretty important facility. It's what we use to know when we get up in the morning, you know, how to make the coffee and how to make the oatmeal. It's what we use when we hear somebody's name and we want to try to remember it. It's what we use when we want to remember something we have to pick up at the grocery store. It's what we use to store the sadnesses of our life and the treasures, the wonderful things in life. But I want to ask you now, do you think I could make you remember something that did not happen? Do you think I could make you remember that when you were a child, you saw a cat stuck in a tree and you actually spent some time to rescue that cat? Do you think I could make you remember, if it didn't happen, that you were attacked by a vicious animal or you were a victim of a serious indoor or outdoor accident? Do you think I could make you remember that when you were a teenager, you committed a crime, and the crime was serious enough that the police came? Do you think I could make you remember that just last week you cheated at a game and you took money out of the game bank when you weren't supposed to do that? I'm going to ask you those questions again at the end of this talk. But before I go on, I just wanted to spend a moment. Maybe we're all a little sick of the election and sick of the post-election activities and sick of what we have to watch on TV. But there was something that happened during this election cycle that really relates quite well to what I want to talk about here today. Donald Trump ran some negative ads about Hillary Clinton. You know, these ads where he called her a liar. She lied about Benghazi. She lied about her emails. She lied about landing in Bosnia. And when I saw this ad, I thought, well, wait a minute. I mean, I know something about that landing in Bosnia supposed lie, because that's been my favorite example to include in various talks that I've been giving since 2008. And let me just tell you the story there in case you don't know it. When Hillary Clinton was running the last time for the Democratic nomination for the presidency, she talked about how she landed in Bosnia under sniper fire. She said, "I remember landing under sniper fire. There was supposed to be some kind of greeting ceremony at the airport. But instead, we just had to run with our heads down to get to the vehicles to get to our base." And I remember thinking at that time, particularly when this story had some light shed on it, what was Hillary thinking? Yes, she went to Bosnia. She did actually land in Bosnia, but she didn't go by herself. She went with other people, and some of those other people were taking photographs and even videos. And so here are some of the photographs that were taken of that landing in Bosnia. You can see that it's a peaceful greeting ceremony. She's being greeted by children and by some soldiers. She's there with her daughter Chelsea in the days when Chelsea had curly hair. So what is going on here? Okay, admittedly, the actual landing had happened in 1996, so some 12 years earlier. But what is going on with her story? As you can imagine, the pundits had a field day with this. And one of them gave her four Pinocchios. Four Pinocchios because there was no corkscrew landing, as she had described, no sniper fire, no canceled airport reception, and she was not the first lady to go into a war zone. Well, Hillary right away came forward with an explanation when confronted with the evidence that her story was impossible and completely wrong. She had this to say. She said, I made a mistake. I had a different memory. I made a mistake that proves I'm human, which for some people is a revelation, she said. Well, now let's go back to Donald Trump. When he was running for the Republican nomination this time, he talked about a memory that he had after 9/11, watching in Jersey City, New Jersey, where thousands and thousands of people were cheering as the building was coming down. It's been pretty well established that this never happened. Has he come out with an explanation? No, but we can only speculate what that explanation would be. You know, it's either crooked Hillary made him say it, or the media is hiding all the evidence that would allow him to prove that he's actually right. So, you know, I actually get a kick out of collecting every now and then the memory failures of politicians and other famous people, news anchors in the case of Brian Williams. But I do that kind of as a hobby. Most of the time, I am thinking about memory and the application of the scientific work that I do to legal cases. And so I spend a whole lot of time thinking about the people in our society who've been convicted of crimes that they didn't do. So, for example, there's one project in New York, the Innocence Project, where information has been gathered on more than 300, I think maybe they're up to 347 people, but well over 300 people, people who spent 10, 15, 20 years in prison for serious crimes that we now know they didn't do, because DNA testing was ultimately done and proved their actual innocence. And when these cases have been analyzed, it's been discovered that the major cause of these wrongful convictions, responsible in more than 70% of the cases, is faulty human memory. So when I'm teaching this topic at the university, I like to motivate the importance of the study of memory with my students by talking about some of these wrongfully convicted people and the role that faulty memory played in that false conviction. So what is the work? Over the past four decades, I and my collaborators, including one who happens to be sitting in the back row here, have been showing people films of accidents. In one paradigm that I started using in the 1970s, we would show people films of accidents. This is sometimes called the misinformation paradigm, where people will see some event. It might be an accident. It might be a simulated crime. They are later exposed to some post-event information about the crime or accident, and sometimes that information is misleading. And then our research witnesses are tested to see what it is they can remember about what they saw. And so we've done many experiments where we showed people simulated accidents, and then post-event misinformation is used to distort their memory for the details of what they saw. In one of my older studies, we showed people a simulated accident where a car goes through an intersection with a stop sign, and by asking a single leading question that suggests it was a yield sign and not a stop sign, we get lots and lots of people to believe in and remember that they saw a yield sign at the intersection, not a stop sign. In some more recent work, we've exposed soldiers, part of our military, to a 30-minute, very aggressive, hostile interrogation. And later on, they're going to answer questions about what happened in this hostile, aggressive interrogation. And when we supplied these soldiers with misinformation about the person who actually conducted the interrogation, we get lots and lots of these trained soldiers to misidentify the person. They may have seen the person on your left, but after misinformation that suggested someone else, many of these soldiers now misremember the person on the right as having conducted that interrogation, somebody who doesn't even remotely resemble what we're calling the actual perpetrator here. So these are some examples of the kind of earlier work that I did, and work that continues today, not only in my research laboratory, but in other laboratories around the world, on misinformation, the power of misinformation to influence people's recollections about what they experienced in the past. And I think we should all care about this, because out there in the real world, misinformation is everywhere. So we get misinformation when we are interrogated about some event we might have experienced, and maybe we get interrogated by somebody who's asking questions, who's got an agenda, who's got a hypothesis about what happened, who can communicate that hypothesis even inadvertently. We get misinformation when multiple witnesses to a common event start talking with each other and share information, and sometimes that information is erroneous. We get misinformation when we turn on the news or open the newspaper and maybe we read about or see some report about an event we might have experienced ourselves, some high publicity event. All of these provide the opportunity for new information to become available and to cause an alteration, a contamination, a distortion in the prior memory. In the 1990s, we began to see an altogether more extreme form of memory problem. We began to see this kind of situation. She goes into therapy because she's got depression, or maybe she's got an eating disorder. And she ends up with a therapist who says something like, you know, everybody I've seen with those symptoms, like you have, was sexually abused as a child. I wonder if anything like that happened to you. And there begins this highly suggestive psychotherapeutic process that leads these individuals, these patients, to start to believe and then to even feel they're remembering horrific childhood abuse that they allegedly repressed. Sometimes even remembering things like being raped in satanic rituals, where they were forced to endure animal sacrifice, baby breeding, baby sacrifice, the works. And when I began to see these cases, because people started suing their parents, their other relatives, their former neighbors, their former teachers, their former everybody for these alleged crimes, you can't help but ask, Where are these bizarre memories coming from? And in virtually all of these cases, the litigated cases, there's some kind of psychotherapy going on. So what is going on in this psychotherapy? It turns out we would find certain techniques that I would call highly suggestive techniques, like guided imagination. You don't remember, you're depressed, you got an eating disorder. You know, people I've seen with your symptoms, they were sexually abused. Oh, you say that didn't happen, but many people repress their memories, and what they need to do is recover these memories in order to heal themselves. So why don't you just close your eyes and think about who might have done this to you? I don't know, Daddy? And how old might you have been, and where might this have happened? What does this guided imagination do to people who didn't have the experience that you're guiding them through? How about dream interpretation? We would see a lot of sexualized dream interpretation. And I do have to say, if you've ever been in therapy or you've done therapy, it's common for people to talk about their dreams. If you recognize the day residue gets into your dreams at night, what you're worrying about during the day, can find its way into your dreams as dream material. It's okay to talk about what you dreamt last night as a starting point for a conversation. But what was going on in many of these court cases where there were claims of a repressed memory is something else. The patient was reporting the dream, and the therapist was interpreting the dream as having been something that occurred in the past. So she dreamt about a snake, and the therapist said, that's a penis. She dreamt about a serpent, the therapist said, that's a penis. But I had a case that I testified in Seattle, Washington, where the patient told the therapist that she dreamt about a cinnamon roll, and the therapist said, that's a penis. And this is one of the, you know, most useful things about cross-examination is you can probe the mind of the therapist who's testifying on behalf of this accusing patient. What made you think when she told you she dreamt about a cinnamon roll that this was a penis? And the therapist said, well, it was the goo on the cinnamon roll, the goo. And I, you know, I know you'll never think about cinnamon rolls in quite the same way after this, but hypnosis, especially with highly hypnotizable people, an extra special, easy way to suggest things and to create false beliefs and memories. Exposing people to false information is another way that people have been led in psychotherapy to believe and remember things that didn't happen. So in order to study the kinds of memories that people were producing in this kind of psychotherapy that we were observing, I spent a long time trying to think about how could I study this? How could I create an experimental situation so I could study how, not how you turn a stop sign into a yield sign or make people believe they saw person B commit an act when it was actually A, but how can you plant entirely false memories in the minds of ordinary, otherwise healthy human beings? And it took me actually a couple of years to figure out how I wanted to start to study this. I knew that what I wanted to do is take people who there's no event to begin with, but now we're going to plant a false memory, which we're now calling a rich false memory, and then we're going to test people to see what it is they remember about their past. And if you have worked on a university or college campus and ever been involved in research involving human subjects, then you know that we have to go through ethics committees, we have human subjects review committees, we have to present our proposed research to this committee and get their approval to go ahead and do the research. Because even in the name of science, we can't just do whatever we want with people. So I had to think not only how would I like to study this phenomenon, but how am I going to study it in a way that is not going to offend the Human Subjects Review Committee. And it didn't seem very likely that a suggestion or a proposal that I'm going to make people believe that they were forced by their parents into satanic rituals and they had to do baby breeding and they were raped by the entire satanic cult, that was not going to go over too well. So we needed an analog, and a lot of what psychological science is about is finding those analogs. We wanted to plant a false memory for something that would have been, if it had occurred, at least mildly traumatic to the person. And ultimately, and I've written about the development of this whole idea, we came up with the idea, why don't we try to plant a false memory that when you were 5 or 6 years old, you were lost in a shopping mall, that you were frightened, crying, and you were ultimately rescued by an elderly person and reunited with the family. And we did this in our first study by taking research subjects, contacting the parents or the older siblings of those research subjects, getting information about what happened, what actually did happen in the childhoods of our research subjects, and then with the relative making up a completely made-up story about being lost in a shopping mall near where the family lived, being rescued and reunited with the family. By the time we were done with three suggestive interviews, we found a quarter of our sample of ordinary human beings fell sway to the suggestion and began to remember all or part of this made-up experience about being lost in the mall. Critics came forward even before we published the findings. I had presented them in a scientific meeting. The critics, especially some of the psychotherapists who could see where we were going with this, they came out of the woodwork. They started attacking the study. And one of their criticisms was actually a pretty good criticism. They said, look, getting lost is so common. At least show us you can do plant a false memory of something that would be a little more unusual, a little more bizarre, if it had actually happened. Well, other investigators and we too came forward with these experimental studies. So one group in Tennessee planted a false memory that when you were a kid, you nearly drowned and had to be rescued by a lifeguard, succeeding with about a third of their subjects. And a group in Canada planted a false memory that you were attacked by a vicious animal as a child or had a serious indoor or outdoor accident. They were getting really good at this because they succeeded in planting a partial or a complete false memory in about half of their subjects. I collaborated with an Italian collaborator, and we planted a false memory that when you were a kid, you witnessed a person being demonically possessed. And about a year and a half ago, another study out of Canada, planting a false memory that when you were a teenager, you committed a crime, and it was serious enough that it involved police presence. The police actually came, and they succeeded with a majority of their subjects in planting at least a partial or a complete false memory or a belief that this had actually happened to them. So these are pretty strong forms of suggestion. You know, we've talked to your mother, we found out some things that happened to you, we want to see what you remember. What about forms of suggestion that aren't quite as strong? We've studied those too. And so, for example, inspired by what I saw going on in this psychotherapy, we've done studies of guided imagination and have shown that if you guide people through imagination, you can get them to believe and remember and think they remember the things that you've just asked them to imagine. We've used dream interpretation, and we can get people to believe and remember based on the way we interpret the dreams. Others have used hypnosis to plant false memories very successfully. We've exposed people to other people's memories. This is, by the way, the kind of thing that goes on in some group therapy, where I've had friends characterize group therapy as imagine you're sitting around group therapy, you're sharing your experiences. Sometimes this can be pretty comforting, but it can also be suggestive. And one of my colleagues referred to this group therapy as kind of memory poker, where I'll match your memory and I'm going to raise you one with my even more bizarre and extreme memory, because that's how you remain interesting. Plying people with false information, I'll give you an example of that in a minute, or the new high-tech way of distorting people's memories through doctored photographs. So I moved to UC Irvine about 14 years ago or so, and one of the topics that my research group picked up on at that time was this. If I plant a false memory in you, what are its repercussions? Does it influence your subsequent thoughts, your subsequent intentions, or even your behavior? And with my collaborators, we decided to study this question, by planting a false memory that as a child you got sick eating a particular food. Because we reasoned that, you know, sometimes when you do get sick eating a particular food, you don't want to eat that food anymore. Well, if we could plant a false memory of getting sick on a particular food, maybe people wouldn't want to eat that food anymore. And so we did studies where we planted a false memory. You got sick on eggs. Or for other subjects, you got sick on pickles. Or for other subjects, you got sick on strawberry ice cream. And we found that people weren't as interested in eating these foods anymore. And you could actually put foods in front of these subjects who had been manipulated in this way, and they ate less of those foods. We've also done a similar study with vodka. This hasn't worked with me, but we can plant a false memory that you got sick on a vodka drink as a teenager, and people are just not that interested in a vodka drink anymore. At some point, I thought to myself, you know, if we could plant a nasty memory and people will avoid the substance, could we do the opposite? Could we plant a warm, fuzzy memory, maybe about a healthy food? And maybe people will want to eat that more. And we did exactly that with asparagus. Planted a false memory that as a child, you know, you just loved asparagus the first time you tried it, you know, get you to imagine and think about it and how you would have felt, and people are more interested in eating asparagus. So I often get asked questions about these findings, and so I can anticipate some of the questions that might be occurring to you. So I often get asked, well, is there any way to tell the difference? When you're hearing somebody describe a memory, can you tell the difference between a true memory and a false one? You might think that people would be maybe more emotional about their true memories than their false memories. But in an excellent dissertation by one of my former graduate students, she planted false memories that you had an event that would have been upsetting had it actually happened, like watching your parents have a physical fight or catching your parents, you know, having sex. And she found other people who truly had the experience, and she got their emotional reactions to their either false or true memory, and basically found that the emotional reactions were equivalent. And so she concluded that emotion is no guarantee of the authenticity of the memory. And I can't tell you how many times I have gone into court as an expert witness after an opposing expert has bolstered the testimony of an accuser and said something along the lines, I know that her memory is real because of the emotion she expressed when she told me about it. Maybe the brain knows. Maybe if we could do some kind of neuroimaging, functional magnetic resonance imaging, or PET scans or something, while people are recounting true and false memories, maybe the brain knows. But in collaboration with some investigators who know a whole lot about neuroimaging, we put people in a scanner, and they were recounting either true memories or false memories that they held on to because of suggestion. And the overwhelming impression in this research was the similarity in the neural signals for the true and the false memory. I'm often asked whether everyone is susceptible to these kinds of manipulations. Are there any of us out there who might be immune to having their autobiographies be tampered with in these ways? Well, we had a chance to study a pretty sensational group of people. My colleagues at UC Irvine have been studying this group of people for 10 years now. They have highly superior autobiographical memories. In fact, they're called HSAMs, for highly superior autobiographical memories. They remember just about everything they did every day of their adult life. They've been featured several times on 60 Minutes. There's been a lot of interest in trying to understand this special but pretty rare group of people. There may be about 50 of them now that have come to the attention of my colleagues on the other side of the campus. So my lab and the lab that studies these HSAMs got together to do a joint project in which we ran these HSAMs through some of these false memory studies, some of the different paradigms that are commonly used in this line of research. And there's the group of collaborators. The basic idea is to take these people who have a superior memory, find some age match controls, and expose them to suggestive memory paradigms and see how the two groups perform. And basically, what this study showed is the equivalence in the susceptibility to contamination. In another recent project conducted by a former graduate student, his dissertation work looked at deliberate lying or storytelling. You know, in some of our other studies, there's a lot of deception involved, but you don't even need a lot of deception. In this particular line of work, the subjects were just encouraged to make up a story about rescuing a cat, finding a cat stuck in a tree and rescuing it as a child. And you've got to make up a story that is so convincing that when someone else hears your story, they're going to believe it. And so the subjects think about this for a while, and they make up a story, and they might write about 250 words. So that's about a page of text, double-spaced. And that's what they do. Later on, when we ask them again whether they ever rescued a cat in a tree, some of these individuals will move in the direction of starting to believe and remember the story that they made up, even though they knew they were just making up a false story at the time they made it up. And anyhow, this is work done, as I said, by a former graduate student. You see, in some of these studies, I have a journal name next to the authors and along with the year when it was published. There's no journal name here because the paper, well, in the scientific field, we say it's under revision, but probably a more truthful way to characterize it is it's between rejections right now. But we have every belief that this is going to find a good home in a good scientific journal. Okay, so you can now not only distort people's memories for events that they actually did experience, turn the stop sign into a yield sign, make people believe person, you know, it was person B when it was really person A, but now I've shown you a number of experimental demonstrations, and there are many more out there that are being done in laboratories around the world that show that you can plant these rich false memories into the minds of people, and it's not that hard to do. Just this month, a group of researchers got together and analyzed the data from, I think it's 8 different rich false memory studies, looking at the transcripts of what people say, coding those transcripts according to whether or not people actually developed a rich false memory or a strong belief that it happened. Over 400 participants in this collection of studies, and when taken together, about 30% developed some kind of rich false memory, and an additional 23% came to accept the story and believe that it's true about them. So what do we do with this mind technology? Given how good We are at planting false memories in the minds of otherwise healthy human beings and affecting what they think, what they intend to do, what they actually do. Obviously, this raises some serious ethical issues and issues for our society. And amongst them is this. When should we, if ever, when should we use this kind of mind technology? Should we ever affirmatively use it to help people live a happier or a healthier life? And should we ever think about banning its use? And these are the kinds of questions, not for me as an experimental psychologist to be the one to answer. It's going to have to be a kind of a societal issue on when should we use these techniques and when should we ban them. So going back to that question that I asked you in the beginning, do you think I could make you remember if it didn't happen? Could I make you remember that as a child you rescued a cat in a tree? Brenda showed you can. Could I make you remember that you were attacked by a vicious animal? The Canadian study showed you can. Could I make you remember that as a teenager you committed a crime and it was serious enough that the police came? A group in Canada showed that you can. Could I make you remember that last week you played a game and you took money out of a bank that you weren't supposed to take? A group in England showed that you easily can. So I've been working on these problems for now 4 decades. And I would say if I've learned anything in all this time about the workings of the human mind, it's this lesson. Maybe it's my one take-home message, that just because somebody tells you something with a whole lot of confidence, just because they describe it in a whole lot of detail, just because they express a lot of emotion and they maybe even cry while they're telling you, it doesn't mean that it really happened. You need independent corroboration to know whether you're dealing with a genuine memory, something that's a product of your own perception and your own senses, or a product of some other process, imagination or some other process. And I think that this realization has made me a little bit more tolerant of the kinds of memory mistakes that people around me sometimes make, friends, family members. I don't immediately assume that they're deliberately lying. Maybe they have a false memory and they genuinely believe in what they're saying. And I think and hope that this group can think about this basic scientific work and how it might help us understand some of the things that you'd like to understand. Like how it is that people can believe that they were abducted by aliens and taken up into spaceships and sexually experimented upon before being brought back to their beds on Earth. How can that happen? And often these suggestive techniques, including a lot of hypnosis, are involved in, and are predecessors of the development of these beliefs. How can people really believe they saw Jesus in toast? Or any of the things that people often do that we think are, you know, a little nutty? Look for the kinds of suggestion that they've been exposed to, the external suggestion, or sometimes even internal suggestion, because this is called auto-suggestion. We can suggest things to ourselves, and these self-suggestions can act like external influences and contaminate, distort, or manipulate our memory. Such a realization might have helped some of those 347 people who were wrongfully convicted who spent 10, 15, 20 years in prison before DNA testing proved their actual innocence. Collectively, over 4,000 years. Because they really learned the hard way, this lesson, that memory, like liberty, is a fragile thing. Thank you. Thank you.
Elizabeth Loftus, ladies and gentlemen. Very nice.
Thank you.
If you don't mind, I have one quick question.
Sure.
How do you implant memory of being sick on pickles? What is the process?
Well, actually, I didn't go into the method that much, although I do have to say on my UC Irvine website, I have about 50 of my scientific publications, links to them, so you can download the method for any of these studies, for the Lost in the Mall study, for the pickle study, for the strawberry ice cream study, for the demonic possession study. And in some of these articles, I will review the work of others. But the way we did it, I'm glad you asked that, George, because—
Not that I want to use it for nefarious reasons or anything.
No. When we did the Lost in the Mall study, if you were my subject, I would actually contact your mother, and I would say, you know, George is going to be a research subject, and what we would like is to get some information about George's childhood from you. And your mother would give me three true experiences, things that really did happen to little George when he was 5 or 6, and then a made-up experience about how you were lost in a shopping mall at 5 or 6. And if you're too old to, or didn't live in an area where there were shopping malls, then we'd have you lost in a JCPenney's or in a Sears store or some other public place. I would tell you that we talked to your mother, and we want to see what you can remember about what she remembered. If you don't remember, just say, "I don't remember." And that is how the suggestive interview proceeds. But wait, that method is time-consuming. I got to find your mother. I mean, you give me her number, but I got to spend time with her getting all the information, making up the made-up memory, run you individually. We now know a much more efficient way of planting false memories in a large group of people at one time. And that's what happened in the pickle study. So in the pickle study, you just bring people in, you get a whole bunch of information from them, their interests in food, their thoughts, their personality measures or something, then they go away. They come back a week later, and we tell them, we have fed all of your data from last week into our really smart computer program that has determined that certain things almost certainly happened to you as a child. And we hand you this individualized profile. It says George there. You think it's just for you. You don't realize that all these other people have a similar one. And on that list is you got sick eating pickles. Embedded in a list of other things we think are true of many kids, you dislike spinach, you love chocolate cake kind of thing. And you have to think about these experiences and dwell on them and try to remember them. That's the way the really smart computer knows it happened to you. Now work on remembering it.
That's fantastic. That's fantastic. Yeah. I'm glad you're on our team. That's great. Yeah. Elizabeth Loftus, ladies and gentlemen. We got to move on. Thank you so much. Congrats. Wonderfully done.